Well, hey, it's good to meet you. My name is Baret, and I'm so glad to be able to share with you here today at the Academy of Preachers. And I got to meet some of you all yesterday and got to start to share a little bit of the God, some of the stuff in common with you all. And I found out that we have a lot in common. Oh, yes. But about 2 months ago, we all shared a common feeling. And the common feeling was thus follow. We signed up to be here at the Preaching Festival. We got really excited. And then we had our hopes and dreams just kind of dashed away. Because we got an email from Lee Huckleberry, and he said to us, please submit to us the text that you will be preaching. And if you were like me, then you had a mini panic attack, and your heart started beating really fast, you started getting beads of sweat. You started getting tunnel vision as you narrowed in on the computer screen, looking at the text, looking at your text, looking at the text, reading the text, looking at the text, and then you came to the starting point with a conclusion that I just don't want to preach any of this. Did anybody else feel like that, seriously? Oh, we got to, I was just like, are you kidding me? And from the pressure of procrastination, I was just like, I don't know, I'll choose that one. So I chose Luke chapter 11, verses 1 through 13. And it was still my soul. I sat down and played Xbox, and then I realized after I'd sent off the email that I had done a horrible thing. Because in my mind, I chose probably the worst piece of scripture to ever preach here at the Preaching Festival. Now, you may be saying, heretic. I say, you nay. Because there is just so much that you can preach on the Lord's Prayer that honestly, if you allow me to, I will be here today, tomorrow, the next day, just kind of carrying on for your benefit. We will keep you here for another 14 minutes and 30 seconds. Let's read this text, shall we? Verses 1 through 4. It happened that while Jesus was praying in a certain place, after he had finished, one of his disciples said, Lord, teach us to pray, just as John taught his disciples. And he said to them, when you pray, say, Father, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come. Give us each day our daily bread and forgive us of our sins, for we also forgive those who are indebted to us. And lead us not into temptation. Now we all come from different backgrounds. We all come from different levels or faith denominations in the Christian faith. So there's probably nothing new that I can share with you about the content of the Lord's Prayer that you haven't already heard or don't already believe in. So to me, it would seem kind of pointless if I stood up here for 15 minutes and just kind of talked what I think the model prayer should be for our society to a bunch of people that might not share the same belief as I do about this model prayer. That's absolutely fine. And instead of you going, thanks, Spirit, for that model prayer, I'm going to go take my coin elsewhere. Think of it like this. Instead of focusing on this morning on what the content of the Lord's Prayer should be, I would like to focus on that we should be praying, a model prayer. And that element is located within the Greek text. And the Gospel writer uses a particular Greek word. It's a very common word that's used throughout the Greek. But he uses the phrase, hoton proyuskoma. Now, does anybody know what the Greek word hoton means? Any of you Greek scholars? I see you thinking. It means whenever. And it's not like a whenever. It is a whenever. And the phrase goes, whenever you pray, pray like this, Jesus says. Now, it's my understanding, and it's your understanding, that when Jesus teaches about prayer and fasting and giving alms, he says something like this, hey, when you give alms, don't be like the hypocrites who do this, but do this instead. Hey, when you fast, don't disfigure your faces like the hypocrites do. Do something else. So that leads me to assume that if Jesus says, hey, pray like this, we should probably be praying like this. Just my assumption. But let's continue with the text, verses 2 through 4. Father, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Give us each day our daily bread and forgive us our sins, for we also forgive those who are indebted to us, and lead us not into temptation. The name that Jesus is using to refer to his Heavenly Father is the Aramaic reference, Abba. And it has this kind of personal connotation surrounding it. Now, who in here is a dad? Your dad? No, not my dad. What's your name? Matt. Hey. All right, nice to meet you. Got a question for you. The question is, what's your name? Oh, sorry.
Matt,
sorry. So Matt. Anyway, Matt, your son, what's your son's name?
I have a daughter.
Daughter, sorry, my fault.
Kate.
That's okay. Kate. Kate, call you what?
Dada. She just learned to talk.
Okay, well, let's pretend she can't say Dada, and she says Dad instead.
Okay.
sorry.
I was so she calls, sorry.
She calls you Dad. But Matt, can I refer to you as Matt? That's socially acceptable, right? Can I refer to him as Father? Dad? Can I say, hey, Dad?
That'd be a little weird.
That'd be a little weird, wouldn't it? You better believe it. It's like my dad. He's right there. His name's Keith. And I can call him Keith because that's his name. But I call him Dad. You know why? Because we've had this relationship going on for the past 23 years. And it's got this intimate, personal connotation surrounding it. And that's exactly how Jesus opens up his prayer. He has this intimate, personal connotation surrounding it to an intimate and personal God. That's so awesome, that'll preach. You know, that's amazing. You're telling me, if I'm in the same room with the President of the United States, if I don't agree with him, even if I don't like him, regardless or not, I'm not going to call him Barack or George. I have to refer to him as what? Mr. President. I can't touch the Queen of England, let alone make eye contact with her for so long, but I can refer to the God of the universe as my dad? Are you kidding me? That blows my mind. And Jesus will use these next two illustrations to link us after his model prayer into this. Well, he gives a couple of instances, but I want you to notice the element of hotan behind these. Notice the element of when, verses 5 through 8. He said to them, suppose one of you has a friend, and he goes to him at midnight and says to him, friend, put me three loaves, for a friend of mine has come from a journey and I have nothing to set for him. And he answers inside and says, do not bother me. The door has already been shut, and my children and I are in bed. I cannot get up and give you anything. Now, Jesus' audience would have been appalled. They would have been like, are you kidding me? He can't get up and give him anything? He's not just a villager, a person, a journeyman from another village who's just the guest of that man. He's the guest of the entire village. How dare you? How dare you? Jesus says. Or Jesus' audience would have said. And look what he says in verse 8. It's so funny. Jesus, I love it. It's hilarious. I tell you that even though he will not get up and give him anything because he's his friend, yet because of his persistence, he will get up and give him as much as he needs. It's not because you're my friend that I'm going to get up and give you three loaves of bread. It's because you keep knocking and annoying me that I'm going to get up and give you three loaves of bread. Now please, don't fall into the trap of what most preachers, I mean people, will tell you that this text means. This text means that if you are just persistent in God with prayer, he will answer your prayer. And I just don't believe that. Because that were true, I would be really persistent about winning the lottery. If that were true, then that means that God is sleepyhead God on his couch with his children, and his children are in bed with him, and God's saying, I can't get to you right now. The door is shut. And we're knocking on the door of God saying, hey, God, I need you right now. And God says, no, I don't get that. But wait a minute, we can summon God whenever we want to. That's why I just don't believe in persistence in prayer. Instead, I think that this parable is demonstrating that unlike the friend, you don't have to knock on the door of sleepyhead God and wake him up from his afternoon nap in order to get something.